Hell there, lollygaggers. We are Lollygagging Sports. I'm Bo Reed along with Samantha Button and Matthew Irby. Samantha, for the first time in a while, I got to just pick the opening audio. So naturally, I go with a little Def Leppard. Just, you know, off the top.
I'm happy for you.
My creative juices have been robbed by the time capsule. I'm kidding. I love the time capsule. I'm going to miss it this week. Gonna miss it. How you doing?
Better than Garrett Cole.
Ooh. Yeah, we're going to get into that in a second. Irby, how about you? Are you also doing better than Garrett Cole?
Yes. I'm checking. Yep. My elbows are good.
Yep. No. You don't need a fifth opinion on your elbow.
That was definitely a situation. A 4 out of 5 Yankees doctors say it's fine. Well, it's the fifth. The fifth is an actual doctor who's going to tell you that dash between 1 and 2 months is what you need to take away.
Oh, Lord, that's one way of putting it. All right, Samantha, real quick, let's get into this. Obviously, we're going to talk about the Yankees as well here in a second. We're going to be previewing the American League East and the National League East this week. But right now, all the news is in the American League East, specifically with the Yankees. Let's talk Garrett Cole, Samantha, because, I mean, we've talked about this till the end of the earth and back about the arm. Right? Like, this is one of those things that fascinates us. We have conversation after conversation, so it's always interesting when something like this hits, because we get the new wrinkle, we get the new excuse, we get the new timeline, we get the new possible, it could be this, but not that. At the end of the day, Samantha, I think we both know what this is.
Yeah, every time you get the news where it's like, well, he's having an MRI, well, it revealed no structural damage, but he's going to be out for 1 to 2 months. Then we'll reassess. It's like they're easing you into what we all know is happening here. So, and I know it's tough, especially with Cole, who has been really durable actually for most of his career. I mean, not mentally so much, but physically has been extremely durable throughout his entire career. But like, I think we all know where this is heading, right? It's heading the same place that this always goes, and it's not good.
No, it's not good. I think Irby's absolutely right. The way this is going to end up, just take out the dash between 1 and 2. This is going to be what it is, because, and this is what drives me nuts every time, especially the higher profile the pitcher, the more ridiculous the smoke is, right? So what we were told today after he'd gone to four different Yankee doctors said they don't see a tear, but they see inflammation. Samantha, we talked about this earlier. Inflammation does not just exist in a vacuum. Like, your arm just doesn't suddenly develop inflammation in the elbow. Right, it just doesn't do it. Something is causing that inflammation, and then they may not be able to see it right now, but it's going to show its ugly face pretty soon.
Yeah, there is a lot of sort of like deliberate misunderstanding of how an MRI works amongst like PR flags in the baseball world when it's convenient to do so. It's like, yeah, you guys, that doesn't mean no. You notice how they use the word revealed. It reveals no tear. It didn't say there is no tear, right? There's a big difference between those two things. I urge you, pay attention to the wording. It matters. Like, we all know what this is. Like, and guess what? Like, we all know why they're keeping it a secret, too, right? Like, but guess what? Scott Boras also knows what this is. Like, the price is going up.
Yeah.
Like.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Add a couple of zeros to that Snell offer, and you might be able to get it now. Oh, boy. Well, let's talk about the Yankees first, then, because according to FanGraphs, their projections have the Yankees up. Now, I want to clarify something real quick on this. The projections were updated at 9:30 on Wednesday morning. We found out not the true diagnosis. We got part of the diagnosis for Garrett Cole a couple hours after. So these projections are liable to change, I would think, at least a little bit with Cole at the moment going to miss 1 or 2 months. But right now, Samantha, they have the Yankees on top. The Yankees, of course, lose out on Dylan Cease, who – was traded to the Padres right before we started recording the show this week. So, do we really think that even with a healthy Gerrit Cole, did we really think the Yankees were going to do this, that they were going to be able to take the American League East away from Baltimore, a Baltimore team who did get better? Are they going to win more games? Probably not. But they are better than they were last year, and they were the best team by far in the AL East last year. Did the Yankees get Soto? I don't think that's enough to put them over the top here, even with Gerrit Cole out, especially now. Are we really thinking this, or are the projections just screwy again?
Well, I mean, what are the, do you want to give the over under the projections,
sure,
or do you want me to just, well, do you want me to answer your question first?
Yeah.
Why don't I answer your question
first, yeah,
and then we can get into, so, okay. So if you're just asking me, do I think they will be better than the Orioles record wise? I probably not. I'm not necessarily committed to the Orioles as the winner of this division. I have some thoughts on that too, but like it's a little bit hard for me to buy the Yankees as like, oh, well, everything is fixed. And I would have said the same thing before Cole. I mean, I'm feel more adamant about it now. But I like, look at it this way. If they pick up Snell tomorrow, does that change where you're at on this? I mean, it makes me feel a lot better than it does today, where mm-hmm. there's just nothing. But like, if you're swapping out one Cy Young winner for another, and we were still saying, I don't think this team has it, like, what difference does it make? Like, I'm not convinced this team was the front runner for this division with Cole, with Snell, with whoever. Maybe with both of them we could talk, but obviously that ain't happening.
Right.
So, yeah, I don't buy it. I don't buy it. I mean, it's worth noting that Judge also just had an MRI. Which obviously no damage was found there, so that's good news and everything. But like, I would urge everyone to remember that like Gerrit Cole was actually the one guy who didn't get hurt before on this team. It's all the other people that we were worried about. So that doesn't go away. Now the guy who never gets hurt is hurt too. I don't know that the other injury prone people who get hurt all the time will suddenly not get hurt because the guy who doesn't usually get hurt suddenly got hurt. That doesn't go well.
Like there's some cosmic scale.
Yeah, it's bounced out. Gareth hurts. Fine, yeah.
No. Yeah. What was interesting, though, we found out the results of the Judge MRI the day of because it was clean.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, and also because they had to deliver the news about the other one. So it's like, do you think Judge even needed an MRI? Maybe they just gave him one so that they could be like, okay, so the bad news is Gerrit Cole needs Tommy John surgery, but the good news is Aaron Judge has had an MRI that came back clean. Was he actually hurt? Did he need an MRI? Well, no, but we wanted to give you some good news. So maybe it's a phantom MRI. Mm. Have we considered this?
I mean, I haven't, but I am now. Irby, how about you? What do you think here? The Yankees in the division chances.
Well, I mean, yeah, there's still plenty of solid options, and this is not a team that's all going to fall apart. I'm also in the category of this 1 to 2 month thing. I completely understand what you're doing. Look, we've had four different people tell you it's 1 to 2 months. Do you hear that, Mr. Boris? We don't need your clients because our guy's going to be back in 1 to 2 months. You can tell us 1 to 2 months all you want. Like you said, inflammation doesn't just suddenly... I'm trying right now. I cannot inflame my elbow. That's not how this works. But with the rest of that lineup, like, yes, this is still a good team. The problem is the division. And uh-huh. as we get through these other divisions, there's other divisions out there that they'd be perfectly fine.
Oh, sure.
Now you drop them in the NL Central and you're fine. But unfortunately, you're here with a Baltimore team that won 100 plus games last year, a Blue Jays team that we think might take, I mean, We'll get through all those, but because of the division, no, this is not good news. And Samantha, thank you for making that point. I mean, that's spot on about, like, this is the one guy that stayed healthy while everyone else was dealing with stuff, and now he's hurt too. Like, not a great way to start the season. But if I'm the Yankees internally, I'm already making my mind, like, you're moving forward that he is not here this season, and you start thinking about plan B. Because Gerrit Cole's not pitching for you this season. If he does, hey, great, awesome. Maybe he's got an elbow just like Aaron Rodgers, you know, Achilles tendon, although he didn't play. So I guess not.
Oh, that's okay. He's going to be vice president.
That's true. So,
no.
Thank God.
No.
You know what? The thing is, Samantha, you know, we're going to give the over here in just a second, but the thing is, like, the writing's on the wall that we're heading down the Tommy John Yellow Brick Road. Yep, the writing's on the wall. By the time they actually get around to doing it, he's going to miss half of next year, too.
Yeah, and this is why I never understand kicking the can down the road on these. Like, we all know it's coming, right? We know it, you know it, he knows it, they know it, everybody knows. Mm-hmm. So, like, why, like, I understand wanting to get multiple opinions in case the guy's wrong. By the way, you know, spoiler, the guy's never wrong. It never happens.
Right,
the first three doctors were wrong. It turns out your elbow's fine. No. Yeah, like, why delay the inevitable? All you're doing then is kicking it into next season, and then you have a new problem. So,
All right, so Fangraphs does have the Yankees winning the American League East with 88 wins. Samantha, you taking the over or the under?
Ooh, okay. Oh, for the record, Fangraphs over-unders are a combination of Zips and Schemer, I believe, in case you're curious what projection systems they're using. So just want to put that out there. So 88 over, under. Oh, I'm going to take the under.
Ooh, really? They don't. Yeah. Wow. Interesting.
Everyone's going to get hurt. Like, nobody stayed healthy. I'd take the over, but like, when is this group of people stayed healthy? No way.
That's true.
I'll take the under.
That's true. We're still waiting on the first Stanton injury of the year. Irby, how about you?
Giancarlo's getting upset. Hey, why is it not me? I'm probably the under as well. I do think this is a solid team, and things can change. The Yankees still have the flexibility to add, but where it sits right now with this Cole designation, I'm going to go under.
I hate this number. I hate it because it's kind of where I expect the Yankees to be, but I can't really say push. So I'm going to take the under, too.
They design them that way. Yeah.
I hate this number. All right, let's move on to Tampa. Tampa, who was in the playoffs again last year, been in the World Series twice. The second time, you had more attendance because of the cardboard cutouts. But no matter what, they can't increase attendance, Samantha, no matter what they do. They go to the World Series, their attendance is still dick the next year. What the hell's going on here?
This is what happens when you play baseball inside a high school field house. Look, man, this is the worst ballpark in Major League Baseball. And yes, I'm including the Coliseum, which has sewage leaking into the visitor locker rooms, possums in the press box, and feral cats everywhere. This is still the worst ballpark. I would rather, as far as the fan experience goes, the Coliseum is better, which is horrifying. Like, it just, I mean, this is just, it is the worst place on earth to see a baseball game. Bo, you've been there too. Yeah. You know, like, yeah. It's bad. Like, and I think when you put that together with the fact that while you may be able to build a successful team the way that they do it, it is a really, really unappealing way to build baseball team in terms of fan support because you're just rooting for laundry. And there are people out there who love that, but most of them don't. Most of them would like to attach themselves to a couple of players, and that just isn't how this works. So it is effective, but it's not great for retaining a fan base long term. And also, like, the choke job, like, you choked. This is two choke jobs in a row now in the postseason. So, yeah, you can get there. You're good at getting there. But, you know, they had an embarrassing performance against Cleveland 2 years ago and then an embarrassing performance against Texas last year. So that didn't help, I'm sure.
You know what I think it is? This is the difference between the Trop and the Coliseum. It's the feral cats. The feral cats add at least a little charm to Sewage City.
Local color.
Yeah. They add some charm. Right, yeah. You go to Tampa, you get some really depressing rays in a tank. in right center field where the water's green.
Yeah, it's like, well, the feral cats are free, right? So if you love animals, you're like, look at these guys, they've taken over. This is great, as opposed to those poor sad rays in that tank, which is just the meanest and most depressing thing. So, yeah, maybe it's bad animal karma.
Maybe.
It's bad animal karma.
Irby, what do you think? Is it bad animal karma?
Yes, absolutely. Like, you guys have got me going down. Like, I wanted to talk baseball, but we'll do it real quick. The Rays are going to win more games than we think. There's some solid players here. They traded off a bunch. Rinse, wash, repeat. That's not a bad team, but it's tough. And they're not going to make it far. So, more importantly, this is the bad animal karma. I like that. I kind of now want to sit and dive down of bad experiences and horrible places to play and see, you know, Tampa Bay, how far could we relegate them? Like, how many AAA stadiums are a better experience? How many AA? Like, do we get all the way down to A-ball before we find some that Tampa is better than?
Based on what I've seen of AAA, AA, and single-A ballparks, for the most part, yes.
Yeah, that's what I was afraid of. It's like, no, like, those experiences, yeah, the ones I'm thinking of, I cannot think of anything come to mind. Like, I'm sitting here going, okay, maybe, like, short A-ball or... like out in Bakersfield, California. Okay, maybe that's better than Tampa. But other than that, no. It's lose-lose situation. And it's very unfortunate because as we've seen over the last decade plus, this is a team that, you know, when they're down, they're not down long, and they will bounce back. And they've still got some solid players there. They've got a great prospect coming up. And it's not a terrible team. And they're going to be around. They're going to win more games than they lose because that's what they do. And then they may just trade it all away and win 60 games. And then we'll see them again in 2 years. That's what they do.
You know, Smith, I don't disagree that they're not going to be bad. But I struggle to put them ahead of any other team in this division, and that includes the Red Sox. I struggle to do that.
Well, all right. So what's the over-under on these guys?
86 is the over-under. They have the Rays finishing second, two games behind the Yankees.
I hate this, but I'm like really tempted to take the over with the first round exit in the playoffs.
Ooh.
Like, I think they're going to win a lot of baseball games. I don't think it's going to do them any good. It's not going to boost attendance. It's not going to get them to the World Series. So, like, I think they'll win a lot of baseball games. But I also believe in, like, there's also like a path where they finish behind the Red Sox. I think you're absolutely right about that. I think that's very possible. So I don't know. I mean, this is a tough one. It could go either way. I'm just going to go with the fact that I always think they're going to be worse than they are because they're so freaking depressing.
The aura of the baseball team is good for 10 more losses, right? Like,
worst vibes ever. Like, oh my gosh. Like, yeah, I mean, it's like the Ray tank, like, there goes three, you know, the catwalks, there goes three more. Like, oh, the second you walk in and take a look at it, there goes three more games. And then they put DJ Kitty out there, and I'm down to like 59 wins. But, like,
you know what's,
I don't know.
You know what's actually logic? Actually, it was really more depressing about that team is that they don't have the eccentric fan, right? They don't have the one that's so crazy-go-lucky for the Rays that he dresses up in full costume and comes in with, like a fishing rod and a drum, right? That kind of they don't have that. It's a very boring. You go to a Rays game, it's like you're at a Little League game. Nobody's really paying attention to the field. No one cares. They're chatting with whoever they went to the game with. They're going to grab beers and overpriced hot dogs, right? They're not watching the game. Not once in the entire time I was there did it feel like I was at a Major League Baseball game. There was no fanfare at all.
Would you want to spend 81 days a year in that place?
No, but I'm not a Rays fan.
But that's why they have so few.
You know who would thrive there and really love to play there? Anthony Rendon.
You're right.
That's actually true.
You're right.
Yeah.
I don't care, and neither do you.
That's super genius.
They don't care. Great place for him. Yeah, MVP season for Rendon.
You're so right. That would be great for him. I hope that happens for everybody. He'd be very happy to get
it. Maybe we could work out a trade. We can get Rendon to the Rays, and you know, the Angels aren't a much better drop off, but, you know, maybe we could get Nathaniel Lowe's brother out of there. Get him over to Anaheim. He can play for Wash. You have a lot more fun than Tampa. We should work on
it. Wash is going to kill Anthony Rendon. Like, we're all aware of that, right?
Yes.
Like, there's going to be a murder. Yeah. Like, let's keep Wash out of jail. Like,
the first time Rendon tries to fight an A's fan, Ron Washington's going to come in with a haymaker from behind him.
All right, Irby, what about you? Are you taking the over or the under here with the Rays at 86 wins?
86. I'm going to have to go under. I see, Bo, your scenario of the closer to Boston, below Boston, right at Boston. That's more of what I see this year from this Rays team. I agree with what Samantha said, and I'll say, I mean, this is a Rays team that, yes, they always end up winning more than we expect. It's either 80 wins or 101 wins. Nothing in between.
I think they struggle to get to 80. I think they struggle to get to 80. That's where I'm at. That's where I'm at with the Rays. Come at me in September if I'm wrong. Go, by all means, my Twitter handle is right there for everybody to write down. Go ahead, give me a follow while you're in there. You have to write it down.
But not in October because they won't be there.
Yeah,
that's why I said September.
That's like the safest team in all of Major League Baseball to like give a come at me to the fans.
It's true
because no one's coming.
Well, I mean, but just baseball fans in general love to point out when you're wrong. I found that with
true.
One of my tweets about
Rendon. That is a thing.
Yeah. So come at me if I'm wrong, but I think they struggle to get to 80. So that's where I'm at with the race.
All right.
Third place, according to FanGraphs, is going to be the Toronto Blue Jays. Samantha, they wanted Ohtani, but they got Joey Votto instead. Which is good for Joey. I'm not saying anything bad about Joey. That's good for him. He's going home. He gets to play for his favorite team. But, man, talking about hitting for the fences and barely getting it to the past the plate.
This is like when you're a kid and someone is like, what do you want for Christmas? And you're like, a puppy. And someone gives you a popsicle.
Wow.
It's not that a popsicle is a bad thing to receive. It's just, I mean, and no disrespect to Joey Votto, who is lovely and made hilarious, sad Joey sitting on a bench in Toronto content, which was great. And I'm very happy for him. And I think he can contribute something, but like, we're a long way from like, we didn't re-sign Chapman. We went after Ohtani and face planted. But good news, we got the local guy, like who's 45. This is not great. I'm nervous about this team. Somebody who was at Blue Jays camp told me the vibes were bad there. So, I don't know what that's about, but, I have some concerns. a couple of really talented players and a lot of guys I have a lot of questions about.
What is this thing I was reading about earlier this week about a different plan for Vlad Jr.? You guys
in
hear about this?
Way?
I didn't have time to look into it. I thought maybe you would have. But apparently there's this idea that they would get creative in their use of baby Vlad. I'm not sure what that means, but, you know. Irby, how about you? What do you?
He's a first baseman. How do you get creative with baseman?
I don't know.
Guess what, guys? He's going to DH next week. Okay.
Oh, okay, so back to Joey Votto. Irby, any thoughts here?
So Joey can be the first baseman. What the crap are you playing Justin Turner?
There you go. Yeah.
We're going to be creative. First basemen are not creative. That's just stay over there. That's what I do. Just cover the bag and catch it when we throw it at you.
No, they're not. Look at Nathaniel Lowe. He's like your stereotypical first baseman. Dorky, but kind of good at baseball. What are your thoughts here, though? Joey Votto, Blue Jays. How you feeling about him?
I mean, sure, why not? It's if he makes the team, hopefully we'll see where we're at. You're going to run into the problem. What we were kind of kidding around here, but you know, Votto, Turner, Vlad Jr., you know, baby Vlad, like, these are not guys that can multiple play out in the field here. Like, you only got one DH. No two DHs here. So, yeah, that...
Oh, give Rob Manfred some time.
This is true. But this Toronto team, like, I want to pick over for them here in a little bit. I want to believe in this team. I want to... And if everybody stays healthy, sure, it's going to be fine. But, man, I don't know. I just... It was not a great offseason. You know, Turner, I mean, okay, we know what he's going to do. Kiner Falefa, that kind of... I mean, it does help, but it's what's interesting about this team is and it's painful with the next one that we're going to talk about because we're seeing it happen. You remember a few years ago with this Toronto team, and with Biggio, Bichette, Guerrero, you know, and all this youth, and it was supposed to be, wow, these guys are going to take the AL East by storm. And I don't want to say it's fallen flat on its face, but it definitely has not produced.
No, it hasn't, because they haven't built anything around it. I think that's the thing there. Where's the pitching?
Yeah, the pitching problem remains.
It's like it's
fairly serious there,
right? Like Samantha, that's the point. Like they built this awesome core of kids of major leaguers and forgot to add the pitching.
Well, I mean, I have questions with the offense as well. Like, I mean, this was pointed out on the baseball barbacast this week. Guys were talking about that. Like, who's the third best hitter on the Blue Jays? Like,
bowling ball.
Bowling ball.
I wish that were true. and it might be, and that won't be good news.
It's not good news. Yeah, how much do you think George Springer is regretting this move?
Ask me how many ways I don't feel bad
for George. No, I don't.
I
don't trust that.
I saw that coming. Yep. I didn't have to say that because I knew Samantha would. Yeah. Who cares?
Yeah, I don't know how that guy keeps getting away unscathed, but I'm not having it.
Probably because he wasn't an asshole about it. Like the others were. He didn't apologize, but he wasn't a jackass about it.
Okay.
I'm just giving you a reason.
If I come over and burn down your house, and I just don't tell you it's your fault, I get away with it?
I didn't say it was your fault for the moment. Wait a minute. Now, I never said that it was okay to let him off the hook. I just said that's what people do.
I know, but it's... I can't allow it. I'm sorry, I can't allow it.
All right, over-under on the Blue Jays. Samantha, 85 wins according to FanGraphs.
Under, but barely. I think they'll come close to that.
Irby?
I'm actually going to take the over. It's not by much. It's just more of a, I believe in Toronto more than I do Tampa. So that's where I'm. Those two are going to even each other out for me.
I want to take the over, but by one. Last year they won 89. I think they get to 90 this year. They get the one win to make them a 90-win team.
Oh, so you're taking a big over.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, I am. Oh, yeah, one win over last year.
Okay, nice.
Yeah.
Is that a division winner?
No. No, we're going to talk about them now. Baltimore, according to FanGraphs, is number four on the list. Also with 85 wins, but they're eked out by 1/100th of a percentage point in the win percentage column for some statistical anomaly that Irby has yet to explain to me. But either way, the same number of wins, same number of losses, but a tick below in the win percentage for the Orioles.
It's because it's a leap year.
Yeah, okay. Sure. All right, so we kind of already hinted on this, Samantha, that the Orioles are obviously not a bad team. In fact, they're the opposite of a bad team. But what they did last year really isn't sustainable. We're expecting a little bit of a regression.
Yeah, I think, and this is, I'm not necessarily saying I don't think they'll win the division. I'm not saying I do think that, but it's very possible, I think. I mean, I probably would put better odds on them than anyone else in this division right now. So I just don't think they're going to win 100 games because that's rare. And they overperformed against talent.
Right.
We're not talking about a team that looks on paper like it should be able to win that many games. Also, that division was unusually bad last year, and I don't think that's going to happen again. You know, as much as we've taken a lot of unders here, we've talked about a lot of negatives, I don't think this division is going to be as, like, collectively a mess as it was a year ago. So I'm not sure where the wins would come from. I think it's going to be more competitive. That being said, this is still a really good baseball team, and it may very well be the best baseball team in the AL East. At least that's where I'm at right now. So are they going to win 100 games? No, I feel pretty comfortable saying absolutely not. Are they going to win more games than anybody else in this division? I feel kind of okay saying that, too.
Irby, how about you? What are your thoughts here?
I just want to, on Baltimore in particular, uh-huh. Sure, there will be, by definition, some regression. No, I don't see this as a triple-digit win team, but this is also, and this gives away what I've got coming up, this is my division winner. I think this is the best team. I know that, yes, there was some overperforming, but there's also some really good talent coming up as well. You've also now you went out and got a starting pitcher, an ace, in Corbin Burns, who is going to be playing for his future contract. So, unfortunately, you got Craig Kimbrell ending games right now, so that's not going to help. But that alone right there is your regression. There's your drop-off right there. Jackson Holliday, I know we've all heard it over and over again. They got a couple outfielders coming up as well that are not as good. But, unfortunately, it's so crazy because one prospect, we all talk about the one thing. No, these outfielders you'd be talking about just as much, so. This is a youthful team. It is a team that, yes, overperformed last year, but it's a team that got a taste of what it's going to do. It's a team that, you know, when you saw that series against the Rangers and they just got punched in the face, didn't know what to do. That will be very interesting to see how they bounce back from that. And you will be battle-tested, played in the AL East. So, this isn't a triple-digit team, but this is definitely in the 90s for me.
Now, you brought up Jackson Holliday. That's one of two players that we will be talking about throughout this series of previews. Not tonight, but not this week, but it's coming. That I really hope to see on the opening day roster. Jackson Holliday is one of them. Samantha, over under 85 wins for the Orioles.
Oh, I'll take the over. That a 15 win regression?
That's
when the team has not gotten worse? Like, you added Corbin Burns. Like, what? Why would they regress by 15? This doesn't make any sense to me. Like, Craig Kimbrell's not that bad. It will be interesting to see how they handle the Kimbrell Cano business at the back end of the bullpen. That will be interesting, but I do not think it's going to cost them 15 games. This is an easy one. I agree. Right now, I think this is my division winner as well. And I certainly think they're going to win more than 85 games. I will take the over.
Yeah. Irby?
They lost Kyle Gibson. That's why the big drop off.
So you're suggesting that Gibson's better than Burr? I'm kidding. I know you're not. Go ahead.
I'm over. I'm definitely over. I'm over 90 wins as well. Division winner, over 90.
Yeah, I think. Are they going to get to 100? It wouldn't surprise me, but I don't think so. I think I've got them more than 95, 96 win range this year. So I'm also going to take the over. Boston. We have a philosophical shift in Boston, Samantha, we want to talk about here with Craig Breslow now, as opposed to previous. What are we expecting? Obviously, the offseason didn't go the way Boston fans wanted because they were screaming for, they're still screaming for Jordan Montgomery because he's still not signed. So they're screaming for more. They want more. What are we thinking so far?
This is a transition year, and you know, it is the Red Sox, and if they're competing, they will go out at the deadline and acquire. So I think this is a team that unless they're at the bottom of the rebuild cycle, you always have to pay attention to them. That being said, you're transitioning out of, like, you went with, like, these, you had, it was Dombrowski, who was, like, sell your entire farm system and buy a World Series, and then you had High Bloom, who was, like, trade everyone and cut payroll, and now you're trying to do something completely different. So this is, like, the third sort of philosophical shift for the Red Sox in recent history, and this is probably a little bit of balancing of the scales here. I like what I've seen out of Breslow in his previous employment. He's very, very good at, like, draft and develop stuff, particularly with regard to pitching, which has been a little bit up and down for Boston recently. So I think that will help. Financially, I think they are a team that will go where they need to go when the opportunity presents itself. I mean, bringing in DeBailey, I think, is an interesting move as well. So I think for the future, I think ultimately this is going to be a successful and probably more sustainable model than, like, the Dombrowski model is. And certainly, obviously, High and Blue was just really not a fit for this organization. That was, I mean, we said when they made that hire, we said this is a bad call, it's not a good match, and, you know, with predictable results. So yeah, I mean, it's an interesting philosophical shift. I'm excited to see what he can do. He's a really, really smart guy. And has produced some pretty good results as a front office executive in his sort of brief time since retiring from pitching himself. So I think this is a good thing. I just don't know that it's necessarily going to produce much in the way of results this year. And also, you know, the pitching situation there, obviously, with Lucas Giolito. I mean, we all kind of laughed about that when we talked about this a week ago, right? Like, did you really think Lucas Giolito was going to be the thing that was going to push you into the races? He didn't look too good at the end of last year. And Monty's probably not that person either. It doesn't necessarily mean they won't sign him. But ultimately, I think this is probably, yeah, this is headed in the right direction. I just don't know that we're going to see results that quickly.
Irby, anything you want to add here?
No, just practicing patience. The same thing. Practice patience. This is not your year. This is not the year. This is that you can be competitive. You can take the steps forward. You can see who's going to stand out amongst your young players. And it's not a youth situation like you see in Baltimore, but it is some players in here who are, like, you got to show now that you're going to be a sustainable major leaguer. So, yeah, this is a process. It takes time. And Boston, I know Boston fans don't want to take time, but this is not your year. With what else is going on in the division and where these teams are at, this is not the year to go for it. You know, if you're in the conversation, yeah, like Smith said, in July, sure, they'll make some moves and stuff. If the Yankees have bottomed out and Toronto's forgotten how to play and Boston's right in there and Tampa's not sustainable, yeah, there's a wild card that you might see them go after. And this is a team that is going to put up a heck of a fight every single series. But, you know, winning division, winning the whole thing, no, not this year. That's okay. It's not supposed to be your year. Patience. You get there.
What they can do this year is get out of last place and pass the Rays. They can definitely do that. No? Okay. All right, Samantha, last year they won 78. This year's projections are 81-81, 500 right down the middle. What do you think? Over and under?
See, this is the one I hate because 81 sounds about right to me. I'll take the over by one. How about that?
82. What are we on? The Price is Right? Sure. Yeah. Okay. Irby, you want to take 83 and I'll take 84?
No, I'm going to do the opposite, so we stay at 81. I'll take the under and say 8. I got 80. She's got 82. There we go. We made 81.
Oh, boy. Oh, Lord. Okay, you know, I'm going to say 80. I'm going to go one low. Okay. All right. That's the AL East. Let's flip it over to the National League East. Starting with the Braves, Samantha, they won 104 games last year. And then did not get out of the division series, sparking all kinds of ridiculous conversation about how we have to change everything with baseball's postseason. But that's not what we're talking about. So this is a good team to talk about when we want to talk about goofy add-ons, right? The weird. Why did they do this? Did you really think this moves that needle? The Braves, Samantha, added Chris Sale to a team that won 100 games and couldn't make the World Series because is Chris Sale the fix? Is he going to cure all that ails the Braves and getting them past the National League playoffs and then the World Series? Where are we at here? What is going on?
Look, I get this from, like, a front office perspective because, like, you win 104 games, you exit the division series, there's really not anything you can do about that. There's not a move you can make that fixes that. It's like we always say, like, the best team doesn't always win, the hottest team does. So you can get somebody who's a lot better than Chris Sale and add him to your roster and win 105 games this year, and you might still go out in the divisional round. So it's like, it's not a fix, and it's great. I mean, I think this is one of the good things about baseball because it means you can't just buy your way there, and you can't just say, okay, well, regular season champion, you're the World Series winner. Like, you have to play those playoff games, and I think that's wonderful. I'm actually really happy about what happened a year ago. Like, it's hilarious to me that people are crying about this. Like, well, you quit after 104, not my problem. Like,
yeah, I mean, exactly.
You got to play those playoff games. So to me, it's like, but I get it from a front office perspective. It's like, you're not going to go spend a bunch of money on something you don't really need, right? Like, you're not going to go out and get Blake Snell because, like, you won 104 games. Like, how is Blake Snell going to get you from there to the World Series? That's probably not how that would work, right? So what do you do? But you got to do something to show people that you weren't happy with how it finished. So you just add these weird little things. I mean, I personally probably would have gone for something that might have a little more impact. It's like late stage Chris Sale. But I get it. I get it. I mean, you're basically saying, like, look, we're trying to find ways to improve, even though we all know that this is just a game, right? Like, this is all head game. This team is fine as it is currently constructed. You don't need to do this, but, like, you have to be appearing to be doing something, right? We're all just playing the game here.
You know, sidebar, because we haven't talked about this, but I'm kind of curious with the whole, you know, uniform fiasco that's going on in baseball right now. Are we really, how surprised, how have we not had a Chris Sale freakout? Like, of all
maybe
the
this
players.
Is what he always wanted. Maybe this is what he wanted. And Chris Sale's behind all of this.
That would actually make sense. That would make sense.
I could see the Braves covering it up, too. Like, the Braves would try to hush that up, you know. But I don't think the Red Sox would. And he kept it together, you know. So I don't know. I don't know what this is about. Like, maybe he's just calmed down. Maybe he likes the Boston uniforms. Maybe he likes the Braves uniforms. Or maybe he's just biding his time and ramping up.
There it is.
To a really critical moment.
There it is.
Where he will have his meltdown.
Yeah, he wants to wait for the opportune time when they're on national television.
Yeah. Opening day.
Pick your spots.
All right, Samantha, Fangraphs has the Braves at 97 wins. What's your over-under on that?
97, huh?
97.
I will take the under, but barely.
Okay.
Like, I think this is your division winner. I just...
Oh, I agree, yeah.
I think there's too much competition. I'll give them, like, 95, 96.
All right, Irby, what are your thoughts here on the Braves and the goofy add-ons and 97 wins?
The funny thing is when you were first saying goofy add-on, I thought you were talking about the these young pitchers they have coming up. Just name alone. Have you seen these guys? Smith Stauber.
He got sent down. He did.
Yeah, he'll be. But the next one up, Hurston Waldrop. That's the first name.
Waldrop.
And then Spencer Schwellenbach.
Wow.
You know, I'll be honest with you. I watched Wonka.
I love it. Like,
I watched Wonka last night for the first time, and I'm surprised I didn't hear any of these names.
Schwellenbach sounds like a candy bar.
It also sounds like one of the people in the Super Bases Loaded game.
Yes.
That is the old Nintendo game.
This is true.
See, now I've got to be a Braves fan because of that.
Well, and it's such a difference from the pitching they have, the names that they have up there for their pitchers right now. So, yeah. But seriously, no, I'm over. What was the number? You said 97? Is the over-under?
Yes, yeah.
97. I'll go over again. I think this is a 100-win team that has to do with the division as well. Yeah, back to triple digits. Look, it's you guys made a great point, exactly what this is. Like, you didn't have to do a ton. You're going to mix Jackson Kowar, sure, but I love the Kalnick addition and Marco Gonzalez, with Seattle. It's a nice bat that doesn't have to be the guy by any means. So it's already a good lineup, and you've added another solid bat in there. I think this is a really good Braves team. Injury, you know, obviously will be a big thing, but if this is healthy, this is not a team you want to play in any kind of a playoff series. And I know it didn't go great last year, but that's the sport. That's the game. You got to get there. You get these wins to put yourself in the ideal position to win, and then you got to show up. And so that didn't happen, you know, and the format we have, and again, just for the record, I'm going to agree with Samantha. I also like how last year played out.
I'm going to go 98 wins for the Braves this year. I'm going to go one game over. I don't quite have them at triple digits. I think 98 wins. Right. Moving on to those Phillies. Last year's National League runner-up. It seems to be all they do these days, Samantha. Not all they do, because they went to the World Series a couple years ago, but they had the same team again. Every single year, the Phillies just keep running it back, right? Like they're in extension mode. They just keep extending these players. It's a roster that hasn't won the World Series yet. I know they got there, and then they lost to Houston. Last year, they lose the Diamondbacks in the NLCS. They start off the year rough. They have a great second half. They put themselves in position, and then they excel in the playoffs, but then they lose in the NLCS. This doesn't work, especially in baseball. It doesn't work. You got to do something different to your roster. Even teams that win the World Series have to do something different to the roster for the next year.
I mean, I kind of agree with that, but I also feel like you could do a million different things and the odds are you still wouldn't get back there because it's, like, really hard. True, like, it's true. Like we always talk about, like, there's 28 teams won't go to the World Series this year. So that can't be the bar every year. And, I mean, good for every single team that says that is the bar. Well, that's what we want, right? I mean, in an ideal world, we'd have 30 teams saying that was their goal every year. But, I mean, this is the kind of competition we want. But at the same time, it's, like, not very realistic to expect you're going to get back. So if the smart play says run it back because you can't really increase your chances from what you're doing, then I don't blame them for doing that. And ultimately, what we've seen in terms of fan enjoyment is that people care more about a consistently good team than they do about a World Series and then a disappearance for 10 years. They're come back to that 54%. I don't mean the way that Seattle interpreted it. I mean the correct interpretation of the 54% model. So what the Phillies are doing is building a team that will remain competitive and that will have a shot at it every year, which ultimately will do a better job of retaining a fan base than winning one World Series and then going away for a while. So it's a smart way to play it. I also think sometimes you have to look at what the market is offering you and decide whether it's smarter to kind of spend in-house. And I think that extending these guys, as much as it's not that exciting and you feel like, oh, they're not doing anything different, it kind of makes you feel like they're not trying. But at the same time, if that's working for you, then I don't know that it necessarily helps you to do something like go out and pay Blake Snell and then not be able to pay the extensions. So especially when you look at the cost difference between the two. So it's more economically efficient to do what they did, and it probably frees up some money so that you can be active at the deadline if you feel it behooves you to do so. So, and they're still linked to Snell. I'm not really sure I'd buy them as a serious contender at this point, but they are technically still linked to him, so I guess we'll see. But, I mean, I kind of don't blame them for this. I think it's a pretty smart strategy. It's a good way to go at it because you're really keeping everyone happy except the people who think that, like, life is a colossal failure if you don't win the World Series every year. And, like, I don't know what to tell you, but you're never going to keep those people happy. I know they're loud, but there actually aren't that many of them. There's not that many people who watch baseball that way.
Irby, how about you? What are your thoughts here on the Phillies?
I don't like those people either, Samantha. They're the ones, too, that even after you win it, they're like, why aren't you doing more to win it again? Like, my gosh, we just won.
Well, it's just a miserable way to watch a sport? Like, I always want to ask those people, are you having any fun? So if you're not the one out of 30 every year, then it's a giant failure? Like, that is a miserable existence.
Mm-hmm. Oh, sure.
Yeah. So on the good notes, yeah, this is a good Phillies team. It's great. Part of me kind of wants them to make it again just so you can sit here and be like, so what did they do to get over the hump? Well, they signed Whit Merrifield and Colby Allard and Spencer Turnbull. That's what it was. that's the pieces that just put us over the hump.
Talk about goofy add-ons.
Like it, not, and none of them is starters. This is different. This is strange. It's will be very intriguing to see this ebb and flow between Atlanta and Philly, just because both teams are so similar to last year. And Atlanta won the regular season, and Philly won the postseason matchup. So here we go. Let's see what happens. Like, so that is exciting from a baseball standpoint. That part is exciting to see these two kind of, you know, I mean, this is the rematch. Here we go. What are we going to do? Or the third match. And it's a good team. If you're keeping these guys around, that's great. I do love the little additions. You know, Bo, you talk about it all the time, you know, the shiny toys, you know, You can't always go after the shiny toy, but there is some, and it's the fan base, and there is some in the clubhouse where when you do add the shiny toy, like you feel a little bit better about situations. So, this is a good Phillies team. They're going to be in the conversation. Barring any major injuries, they're going to be there in September and October and probably playing in October.
All right, Samantha, the over-under here for the Phillies is 85 wins. Where are you at here?
Over.
Over. Irby, how about you?
Yes, over.
Yeah, I'm over too. They were at 90 wins last year. They should at least get to that. They have the same team. That's how baseball works, right? No? Oh, okay.
What? In this case, probably, yes. But
you know, what I do find fun about these projections for the National League East, the Braves and the Phillies were the only one with a positive run differential projection. The Marlins and the Mets and the Nationals are all in the negative. And the best part, the Marlins and Mets are negative 6 run differential. The Nationals, negative 155. That might be the first thing in these projections I've seen they got right.
People projecting run differential makes me want to die. We've gone too far. Stop it.
Those are the same people that are doing mock NFL drafts all 7 rounds.
Like, yes.
Stop.
Yeah.
All right, so in the projections for the National League East, the Marlins and the Mets are projected to finish exactly the same, and they actually have the same winning percentage. So that actually makes sense to me, unlike some of these others. So we're going to go alphabetical, A before E. Samantha, let's talk Marlins. Who should be more offended here between the Marlins and the Mets? Should the Marlins be upset that they're projected to be the same as the Mets this year?
I feel like I'm offended on behalf of both of them, so, which doesn't really say anything great about either one. Like, I don't know, man. If I'm the Marlins, like, I'm looking at the Mets, like, with it's like the succession. It's you are not serious people. But, like, when have the Marlins ever been serious people? Right? Like, because, like, once every, I don't know, 10 years, they manage to, like, put something together before they fire sale it. Like, I mean, obviously the front office shakeup there has been a really bad look for them, like consistently over a number of years, just bad, bad, bad all over again. The Jeter thing, the Kim Ng thing, like this is bad, you know? Mm-hmm. So, and in a lot of ways, you feel like you guys are way less of a trash fire than like the Mets, but like, are they really, are they, or are they just less flamboyont?
I mean, they just had Tim Anderson.
Like, I mean, I just, like, that's speaking of negatives more. Like, don't you lose. We have to knock a few off for Tim Anderson, right? It's just the law of averages says that you must take away a few wins because you have signed Tim Anderson. So, anyway, I'm very comfortable taking the under, even though I don't actually know what the number is at this point. But, yeah, I don't know. I'm offended on behalf of both of them.
Oh, can we just trade Jazz Chisholm and get him out of there? Can we do that? Get him his life raft. He's earned it. Irby, should the Marlins be offended by being the same as the Mets?
Yeah, absolutely. Considering where you are going and the directions your franchises are going, the Marlins took the step forward, and the Mets sent everybody to playoff teams. So, yeah, this is not – the one W here that for the Marlins, this goes to what you guys are saying about Tim Anderson. There might be a bounce back for him, literally there, because you know Miami, very Cuban, very boxing heavy culture. So maybe he'll learn how to fight. He sure can't play baseball, but he might learn how to fight. Or at least take a punch, maybe that much.
Mark your calendars. Guardians Marlins. Round two.
All right. So, Samantha, you asked, 80 is the projection for both the Marlins and the Mets. And the Marlins won 84 last year. Where are we at with 80? Are we taking the over or are we taking the under?
Oh, boy. I expected that to be higher. Now I'm tempted to take the over. Because I do think this is a 500 baseball team.
Yeah.
So, I guess I'll take the over. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Irby, how about you?
Just so that we don't offend him anymore, I'll take the over here.
You don't want Tim Anderson to come looking for you? Is that what it is?
Yeah, that's true. It's...
Are you really worried about whether Tim Anderson is looking for you?
I'm worried about because of the Mets comparison, because I'm going to be taking the under there, and I'll take the over here, but yeah, no, this is above 500 team, sure, 82.
Yeah, I agree, although I think they're 81 and 81, but I'm taking the over as well. All right, let's talk Mets, Samantha. The Mets, the mess that is the New York Mets. It's kind of hard to put any type of expectation on this baseball team, right? You know, they break camp last year with one of the best managers in baseball, a loaded roster, and were absolute duds. Now, you know, they got the closer back. That's good. That's good. That's great. But, you know, what else do they have? It's a mess.
It's a huge mess. And it's, they've sort of told us that this is not their year. Like, they have said that without saying it. So, you know, once a team does that, I think it's kind of like, okay, we're retooling, we're reassessing what we have, which is the thing that they should have done before. And instead they just went shopping in one of those like supermarket sweep style where you just throw everything that you can into the cart and hope it works out. What do you have now? I mean, yeah, you got Diaz, right? That's great. That will help. And you have Pete Alonso. That's also great. Like, other than that, like, okay, it's not like there aren't other good players on this team, but, like, are Pete Alonso and Edwin Diaz going to win you a division? No. Who's pitching for this team? Who's starting for this team? Like, what does the rotation look like? What's the rest of the bullpen look like here? Like, I think this team can score some runs. I just don't think you can stop anybody else from scoring any runs. Like, you know. Diaz, assuming he's healthy, probably going to pitch a clean ninth. How many save situations is he actually going to be in, realistically speaking?
You watch. This will be the year that the Mets win the East.
I feel very comfortable saying it will not.
So do I. But you watch. It's just that this will just be some weird year in the National League East.
Baseball's weird, but it's not that weird.
Irby, anything you would add to the Mets? It's a little weird.
Yeah, they're not winning the East.
Oh, come on. Stop taking my fun away.
No, you can have fun with this team, but just they're not winning the East. They're not winning the NL Central. It's funny, I look at this rotation, Smith, you're talking about who they got pitching. I was like, you know, this rotation in 2013 wouldn't have been that bad. But this is a solid rotation, but that's a decade ago, and things aren't going to work out so well. what is it? My favorite one is of the rotation, the four guys they got up there. Luis Severino is the young guy of your top four.
That's
starting pitchers.
Wow.
Severino is the young one.
That's not cool.
Not good.
That's no good at all.
That's not good. No, this is it's time to rebuild. It's time to rethink. It's time to retool. It's not happening. And the good thing is, so like you said, they kind of addressed that. You know, the first, what do they say? The first step is admitting the problem. Yeah. You're not winning this division. Uh-huh. You're not beating the Braves. You're not beating the Phillies. So the very best you can do is third. Okay. That is the ceiling this year. The pipe dream. Okay. Is third. So no, you don't. go after it playing for third. So you've got ownership that has no problem spending money. You've got a front office that doesn't mind being aggressive, and that's okay. Not this year, not next year. We'll see you in 26.
All right, guys, as the Marlins, also the Mets, 80 is the projected win total. Samantha, where are you at?
Under. I don't think they're going to be horrible. I don't think they're going to be way under that. But, yeah, I'd say mid-70s probably for this team.
Now, they finished with 75 wins last year. So
Sounds about right.
Yeah, I agree. Irby, how about you?
Yeah, this is under. That's a good mark to shoot for.
All right. Well, luckily for the Mets, they had the Nationals, so they're not going to finish last. Let's talk about those Nationals. You know, it's the DC team. So, Samantha, we tried to find the most boring president we could think of in history, and we went with Millard Fillmore. Are they the Millard Fillmore of baseball?
They are. It's like look, there's something about every single team in Major League Baseball that you can get excited about if you look hard enough. But this is one of the harder ones. There's just not a lot going on there. And this was a really, really interesting team just a couple of years ago. And now they are just spectacularly boring. They're not even like fun bad. They're just bad. Right. And they don't look close enough to, yeah, it's not like, wow, these guys are a train wreck. This will be fun to watch. And it's also not like, hey, these guys aren't good, but they're plucky. You know, they look like they're on their way up. They're just bad. And they're not a terribly incompetent organization. So they will get back. You know, Nationals fans, don't worry. You will get back there. But yeah, we're in Millard Fillmore territory right now. We were trying to figure out, like, we were like, okay, well, who's a boring president? Or who's the other one? Zachary Taylor? Was that the other one we were talking about?
Yes.
You need somebody who, like didn't do anything horrible, but like definitely didn't do anything good or interesting. You know, just a guy who was just kind of there, you know, he was there. It happened. We have a record of it. We're not really sure what went on or what it did, but he was there. He was there.
Not only was he boring, but he replaced a president that died in office from eating cherries.
Like it's sort of hilarious when you think about DC and the cherry blossoms.
Yeah.
Incredible. Like, and not the one, wait, was he the one who had the raccoons? Was that him? He might be a little too interesting. Was he the one who had the pet raccoons? Does anybody remember which president that was?
That sounds like something Andrew Jackson would have.
It wasn't Andrew Jackson. Someone had pet raccoons. And it might have been Millard Fillmore. And if it was, then I might have to change this, and we might have to go with Taylor.
No, it was President Coolidge, whose favorite pet was
Thank you.
His favorite pet was a raccoon named Rebecca.
That's a great name for a raccoon.
He built her a special house, visited her every day, and walked her around the White House on a leash.
Love it. Way too interesting to be the Nationals in the year 2024. So, yeah. Coolidge, you will be reassigned to a different team. Possibly the Mets, but not the Nationals. All right, Millard. We're safe. The Millard Fillmore of Major League Baseball in 2024.
Oh, man.
Washington Nationals.
Talk about fun facts I did not have on my bingo card today. That's one. All right. Irby, you want to follow that with... Anything you want to add to that discussion?
I know, man. Y'all went almost hit every category possible there. No, it's so we're sticking with Millard Fillmore. That's good because it is the team that it's just kind of there. And a beautiful filling for that is just, Bo. I know if you knew this or not. This was the landing spot of Joey Gallo. Joey Gallo just happens to be just there.
Who is also the Millard Fillmore left-handed hitter.
Yeah. Like it's
that's perfect, actually. I agree with that.
Yeah. You know, it is a team. You know, I look up and down. You try to get excited, and I could probably, if we had too much time and too many Nationals fans, I would sit here and tell you that, yeah, Josiah Gray looking for another step forward. C.J. Abrams should take another step forward, but No, the future, though, should be, you know, again, should be coming. Dylan Cruz, You might as well give him a shot at some point this year, because the team that's out there isn't going to be the team that when you're good again.
I stopped tracking Joey Gallo when he signed with the Twins. It's like, well, there's no point in following you anymore.
Also, yeah. Miller Fillmore, like, in
All right, Samantha, the Nationals won 71 games last year. They are projected by Fangraphs to win 66 games this year.
Oh, wow. Oh, man, that's bad. Yeah, 66 feels about right. I'm tempted to take the under just to punish them for letting Dom Smith go because I'm angry about that. Although maybe that's ultimately better for Dom Smith. I'm a big Dom Smith fan, in case you're new around these parts. Big fan. I guess I'll take the under, because, like, I mean, do you take the over on Miller Fillmore? You just can't do that. That's unconstitutional, I'm sure.
Irby, you want to violate the Constitution?
The law, yes, I believe that's one days. Of our amendments. One yeah. of our amendments is you take the under on Miller Fillmore. It's at the very bottom in small. Yeah, I'm under as well. This is going to be a dogfight for 60 wins.
Yeah, unfortunately for the Nationals, the pet of Coolidge, the raccoon named Rebecca, has got a better year coming up than they do. I'm also going to take the under. I don't think they get to 66. Wow.
I will take the over on Rebecca. Absolutely. I mean, I don't really know what the criteria is, but that's amazing. So, big fan of that. Big fan of that. Rebecca. So great.
Oh, boy. All right. Well, that's our first round of previews. We've got the Central coming up next week. The West will finish it off right before opening day. We are really close to opening day, guys.
We are. I'm so happy. So excited. And I will talk to you guys live from spring training next week. So,
oh, yeah.
Pretty stoked about that, too. So,
yeah.
Live from Arizona for your AL Central preview and NL Central preview.
All right. Well, that's going to be fun. Looking forward to that. Let's do a segment like Samantha's spring training nuggets or something. Or not. That's going to do it for us. Wherever you're listening to Lollygagging Sports, give us a like, subscribe to the show, leave a review, follow us on Twitter. But for now, we're out of here. Until next week. Spring training games are all over the place. I mean, you watch a little of that college basketball that's going on. It is March after all, but spring training baseball is still king. In your neighborhood, who you gonna call?